Our next physician who I'm going to introduce and speaker is Dr. Gwen Huitt. Many of you know Dr. Huitt. She's a professor of medicine at National Jewish Health and received her training at the University of Colorado in internal medicine and infectious diseases. And she joined the faculty at National Jewish in 1993 and has served for many years as the director of our adult day unit program there. Fondly known as the queen of mycobacteria, I'll hand it over to Dr. Huitt.
The first thing I have to say is I am just awed at this gathering here. So I'm so honored to be a part of it. But the second thing, I just want to take 1 second to give a shout out to, I had a little health speed bump this last year. And literally, our nursing director would send a packet of cards every week to my home while I was recovering from people that know me and people that don't know me. And I just want to say thank you very much, because that made a big difference to me. And I hope I can give that back to you. So, NTM, to treat or not to treat. So we've got a lot to talk about. Oops, wrong way. So I'm on the advisory board for Hillrom, my learning objectives. And just so that everyone knows, we're gonna have these panel discussions, so there's gonna be plenty of opportunity to ask a lot of questions of all of us that are speaking today, and I think that's really one of the best things about this type of gathering, because you guys get a chance to ask all of us questions. We certainly will try to give you our best answer, as Dr. Daly alluded to early. So. Now, anyone who knows me would know that this is my mantra, right? I have to say, this is passed around a lot, and actually it cannot be ascribed fully to Ben, because the word bacteria didn't even exist in the 1700s. So it's been modified a bit, but I think it speaks fairly true to what we're speaking about today. So actually, one of my patients brought me a tablecloth that had this embroidered on it, and I thought, this is too good. I'm so sorry. So all these faces are used with the patient's permission, and to build on Yako's theme, it really is so important that we as patients and physicians and researchers really build on this theme to say that, yes, one patient population that one of us might deal with and be representative of our practice may be entirely different from someone else's practice, and it doesn't mean that one is more important than the other, but we need to pay attention to what groups of people this group of organisms is affecting. I will say my first, not one of my first, I've had so many jobs, and I think we had a dinner last night, I think people think I fabricate my life, but my master's degree is in genetic counseling, and so one of the major things that I learned in the 80s, which was the beginning of genetics, was that everything is a combination of genetics and environment. And as we have just heard, this is not only with the human genetics and the human environment, but the bacteria's genetics and the bacteria's environment. So we have to take kind of these four components into a composite when we're thinking about this whole disease process and the research we want to proceed in and what are the patient populations that we're dealing with. So you've already seen representative CAT scans to show that this disease process, depending on the genetics and the environment of the human and the bacteria, can present quite differently from person to person. So we have basically a normal CAT scan here on the left. We have a pretty severe area of bronchiectasis in this patient, but it's actually not just these two areas, it's quite all over. And then we have a woman who has what we call pectus excavatum, or the breastbone dives in a little bit. Many of these phenotypes, as we call it, the Lady Windermere syndrome, may have a little bit of curvature of the spine. So we've often thought, gosh, is there something to this as well? And certainly Dr. Eisman is my major mentor. He has helped me grow up. I'm still not growing up, but he's tried. He's really tried. And one of the things that he said that one of his mentors said is, we don't do surgery on bronchiectasis because it's just going to come back. And I think that we've modified that thought, and Dr. Mitchell's going to allude to that a little bit more, but that brings up the question, gosh, what is really going on within the rib cage and the lung anatomy that if we take out one area of bronchiectasis, are we home free? Well, maybe not necessarily in some patients, and if that's the case, why? So the theme, unfortunately, today is, with every answer that we get in whatever arena we are studying or working in, we seem to come up with five new questions for every answer that we have. So I think we'll be in business for a while. Well, this alludes to this. What don't we know? Well, we honestly, there are so much more that we don't know than we do. So these are some of the questions that many of my patients ask. Well, what about hormones? If our practice in the United States is mainly women, is it hormonal? Boy, it seems logical, but we don't know. We need to look into that further. Is there a genetic predisposition? Well, yes, there's a genetic predisposition. We haven't the foggiest idea what those genes are. I think we'll figure that out in time, and not only with the human genetic predisposition, but the germ's genetic makeup and how the germ can change from time to kind of rig the game in their favor. As they say, Mother Nature is, generally speaking, always going to win. It's an ongoing battle, and so we keep fighting each individual battle, but it changes. The landscape clearly changes. Is it environmental? Yeah. But what environment? Is it the environment within the airway of that individual human? Is it the environment of the air that they're breathing, or the water that they're drinking, or the dust that they're inhaling, or the country that they live in? Yeah, all those. But this is a very complicated puzzle that we still have a lot to learn. Does vitamin D play a role? I just threw that out there because now there's been a resurgence of a lot of literature regarding vitamin D and many other nutrients, to be honest. And we know that vitamin D does play a role in helping the immune system in many ways do what it's supposed to do. So there's a controversy right now as to what the appropriate level of vitamin D should be, but I think here in Colorado and on our service, we test everyone's vitamin D level, and it's pretty shocking how low, consistently low, many of our patients' vitamin D level is. And so we just try to measure that, try to get them up into a level that's at least considered by the medical community now an appropriate level of vitamin D in their bloodstream. So what do we know? Well, we know that certain diseases may predispose people to acquire these germs and others. And I've just listed a few of these: cystic fibrosis, Yako just alluded to COPD, or really the common term refers to smokers versus non-smokers when you're talking about that group of patients. Pre-existing bronchiectasis, people that have had damaged breathing tubes from other type of infections or other type of issues, and then Mycobacteria finds a wonderful home and haven and comes in and sets up shop. Autoimmune diseases, it can be associated with many different autoimmune diseases, and I just listed a couple, such as Sjogren's syndrome, lupus, and rheumatoid arthritis. And then other diseases that affect the immune system or affect how the cilia in the airways are able to do their job. So if the immune system is not working correctly, or if the little cilia whose job it is to move mucus around cannot function properly, this is probably one of the reasons that it sets up in the lungs, the organism, and the biofilm. So I have two separate cases that I'm not going to bore you with the details, but I think that they're illustrative not only for the patients that are in the audience, but physicians. And I'll allude to the salient point. So this is a woman who's from Florida. I won't comment about Florida. Don't take that personally. So this is an older case. So she was diagnosed with this respiratory tract infection, and her husband, who she shared airspace with, had been diagnosed with a germ called Mycoplasma pneumoniae, and that's kind of it's in between. It's a different kind of bacteria. And we commonly see that spread amongst people, army recruits or people in dormitories. So close contact, it's spread between person to person. You can get a high fever, you can get a bad pneumonia, chest x-ray findings. But he did not take any treatment for the mycoplasma, and she then developed a cough. And a couple months later, her physician prescribed her azithromycin, and she didn't receive any relief from this. So the physician just did it again and did it again. So point number one, if something is not working, at least the first time, but sure the second time, and darn sure the third time, maybe that's not the right direction one should be going in. So if you're not getting the results that you think you should be getting from us, your clinician, or as the clinicians are here as well, if you're not getting a good turnaround in that patient's symptoms with one course of antibiotic, maybe stop and think for a minute just before we just keep providing more and more antibiotics. Well, finally they got a chest x-ray and it was abnormal with some nodules. Then they proceeded on to a CAT scan. I put this out because we have the luxury in the United States of, generally speaking, having access to CAT scans. The important thing is that CAT scans tell us so much more when we're starting the whole process of figuring out what's going on with each patient and how we're going to proceed. A chest x-ray, it tells us if there's big holes in the lungs, if there's big nodules in the lungs, but a lot of times when this disease starts, it's little tiny nodules that are much more difficult to assess just looking at a chest x-ray. And this doc gave the patient the working diagnosis of mycoplasma pneumoniae. Well, so then they said, okay, well, let's give them prednisone. Prednisone decreases inflammation. And let's give clarithromycin, which is just a kissing cousin of azithromycin. Mind you, this patient had already had three courses of azithromycin. So probably it wasn't going to help, and lo and behold, it didn't help. And then they said, oh, let's give more prednisone and a different antibiotic for 7 weeks. You see the futility in this. So then the physician said, okay, let's do a bronchoscopy. Another point that I want to make as far as a practicing clinician, what we hear time and time again now is that docs out in the community have a dickens of a time getting an induced sputum done in so many of their patients. Number one, the hospital doesn't get reimbursed if a respiratory therapist is doing an induced sputum, so it doesn't get done. And what does get reimbursed is a bronchoscopy. Now, a bronchoscopy does more than just get the physician the sputum. They can look at your airway, see how red they are. So a bronchoscopy can be very important and very informative to your physician. But we are so fortunate at National Jewish that we have had the luxury of great respiratory therapy services. And I see Cheryl back here. I mean, we have just the best respiratory therapists, I think, in the country, honestly, who they will beat you silly to get a sputum because they don't want to come back to me and say, we just couldn't get one out. An induced sputum, I think, is the way we would prefer to start out if we can do it because we don't have to subject you to a bronchoscopy. But practically speaking, that may not be feasible, and we understand that. And that's an unfortunate problem with our medical system right now. So it grew Mycobacterium avium. The patient was treated for 2 years of therapy with three different drugs. And 6 months after they stopped the medicines, and she actually, her cough got better. On the three drugs, she was cough-free, doing great. Well, then 6 months later, her cough came back. They did a bronch again and grew a whole different germ, Mycobacterium abscessus, which you've heard. The physician started her on a regimen of which two of the drugs, Biaxin and Amikacin, would work against abscessus, and all of those four drugs will work against avium. So it's a little stronger towards an avium germ, although we hadn't grown avium. And then they did another bronch 3 months later, and it grew abscessus again. So now it seems like the person has a new strain of bacteria. This is a very common scenario that many, if not most of you, have experienced if you've been dealing with this infection for long enough. and I'll allude to how I might approach that. I just put this, there's really nothing in her. She's a never smoker, she's in accounting, she works in an accounting business, and her physical exam was really unremarkable. But lo and behold, this is her CT scan when she came to see us. So pretty significant bronchiectasis, as you can see in the back parts of both sides of her lungs. She's got some stuff elsewhere, but this is pretty significant bronchiectasis. Well, we said, gosh, you're kind of falling out of the realm of normal, so we better do some other tests. There's another view of her CAT scan. Her breathing tests were actually not so bad. Again, the normal range is 80% to 100%. She was in the 60s percentile. Her oxygen transport number was down a bit. That should be in the 80 to 100 range as well. We did a lot of tests for autoimmune disease and immunodeficiency, didn't find it. But then we finally did some testing for these inherited disorders called alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency, and it turns out she had a very abnormal, what we call phenotype, which this is a disease that affects the liver and the lungs, and many lung physicians are taught that this is one of the leading causes, it can be a leading cause of emphysema, and don't focus on bronchiectasis. So take-home point is alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency can be bronchiectasis and not emphysema necessarily. So you have to think about that. And so we found that. But we also tested her genetically for cystic fibrosis, and we found she was a carrier for cystic fibrosis as well. So as I told her, she won the genetic lottery. Unfortunately, probably these, along with other things that we don't know, set her up for mycobacteria. And she had two species. And if we don't pay attention to the things that I'm going to allude to, she'll probably have more in the end. So we had to place a PICC line, start her on medications, and she's actually doing well. Well, as you've already heard, NTM are in all potable water sources. It's also been found in potting soil, in some very high concentrations in potting soil. So one of the things we talk about when we ask patients, do you garden, do you shower, do you bathe? And the reason we do that is not only of your exposure, but what are your activities? And what do you do during the day? Well, biofilms, I'm an infectious disease physician, so biofilm just means slime, okay? So pretty much everything that we deal with as infectious disease doctors has to do with slime somewhere in the body. I guess call us crazy, but we like slime. So that's whether it's a cavity in your tooth, whether it's a bloodstream infection because you had to have a catheter put in your arm, whether it's a urinary tract infection, this all has to do with a slime layer that holds bacteria that may get to where it's not supposed to get. And that holds true certainly for airways. And if there's too much slime, too much inflammation, that ultimately will lead to damage of the breathing tubes, which is called bronchiectasis. Once bronchiectasis occurs, generally speaking, that breathing tube never goes back to its normal size or function, so we have to find ways to manage that, and so we teach you those type of things. And it goes from normal breathing tube to slightly larger breathing tube, but still nice and smooth, to these little outpouching called varicose, and then something kind of what we call end stage, not meaning the person's going to die, but the breathing tube is irreparably severely damaged, called cystic bronchiectasis. So I have this slide up for Richard purposely, and I don't know if you can read this, but when we talk about treatment, I think it's really important that we take a step back and we're logical about how we approach it. So it says, Richard, I don't know if you can read this, but it says, and this is Texas A&M, a banner up top, plywood to protect your store from Hurricane Rita, $200, supplies to hang the plywood, $50, using your Aggie education to hang the plywood on the wrong side of the windows, priceless. Texas and Colorado have this friendly rivalry and always have, so I couldn't pass this up. So as a clinician or as a patient, I think the things that we have to think about is the first thing is take your own pulse and take a step back. We have the tincture of time to figure out a plan. And as I tell many of my patients, okay, well, I have plan A, I have plan B. I don't know what plan C is, but I'll come up with something. And we have a chance to redirect each time. So one need not panic, okay? So how symptomatic is the patient? That's the first thing to take into question. So just because we've grown some germs, tell me what's happening with you, the patient. Do you just have a little throat tickle? Do you have a severe cough that is, you know, you're vomiting because you're coughing so severely, or it's keeping you away from your social activities? Are you a dry cougher or are you a wet cougher? And that can tell us clinically one thing or another. Do you bring up a lot of sputum? And what color is that sputum? Across the pond, they give patients basically paint chip scales. And they say, call us when it gets to green. So it goes from, you know, beige to light yellow to dark yellow to green, and then there's blood on the other end. And seriously, they still do that. And actually, that's a pretty good illustrator to tell the patient, this is kind of when things are going from okay to, oh, we need to look at you again. Do you have a fever? Do you not have a fever? Usually people who have high fevers, 102, 103, 104, this is not truly from NTM as the primary cause. There's probably something else that's going on with the NTM that has caused that degree of fever. Do you have fatigue? Do you have weight loss? So those are some of the clinical questions that I go through. Then next we say, what does your CAT scan look like? Do you have a lot of bronchiectasis? Do you have hardly any bronchiectasis? Do you have a few little nodules? Do you have big nodules? As Yako alluded to, do you have big holes in your lungs? So these are a variety of presentations, and it will help me gauge, and your clinicians and you, the people that are taking medications, okay, well, how aggressive are we thinking? What is the time frame we're thinking about? How are we going to proceed, and what's our next step? Then, sputum culture. So this is a big deal, and I think that you've heard this theme a lot now. We're having some problems right now in our healthcare system, that there is such variance in what insurance companies will allow their physicians, hence the patients, where they'll allow their cultures to be done, how are those results reported out, and you're going to hear this theme time and time again. So as a patient advocate group, along with us that are in this arena, I think we really need to push and push hard to get insurers to allow better information to be obtained by your physician, which will ultimately help you, namely speciation, namely how many colonies are growing, or is it just reported, it's either smear positive or smear negative, or it's culture positive or culture negative. That's where we sort of get into this interpretation thing. Well, do semi-quantitative cultures really help? I'm going to say, personally for me, they do. I think now, because I have the luxury of gauging my patients over time, if they're less than 50 colonies and they're not terribly ill, and their CAT scan's not terrible, we have definitely the tincture of time that we don't necessarily have to launch into any treatment right now. Let's just get the lay of the land, get a few different sputums over time, and see what our trend is showing us. What germ is it? As you've already heard, there's a difference between which germ we're seeing. Is it an abscessus-like germ, which is probably more aggressive in many of us, or is it a MAC germ, avium germ, that's not quite as aggressive probably in most of us? That's really important. Are we seeing them all the time? Are we seeing the same germ all the time? So like in that first case that I alluded to, gosh, we had two separate germs. Are we constantly seeing two separate germs, or is it changing? Is the pattern changing of the cultures? And you already heard about the ERM gene, how that's really important. And this is new news. So, from a treatment standpoint, this is huge. Is it Moeselliense or is it abscessus? And right now, I would say we're not able to get that information uniformly from many labs. So that makes a difference to you as the patient and to the clinician that's trying to take care of the patient. So for MAC-like organisms, I just put this in. The ATS guidelines are accessible to anyone, but generally we use azithromycin, rifampin, and ethambutol. We tend to use azithromycin more than clarithromycin because clarithromycin tends in probably about 20% of the people, maybe even 30%, make you, it's like you're sucking on a lead pipe. So it gives you a lot of bad taste in your mouth, and there's a drug-drug interaction between clarithromycin and rifampin, so we have to increase the amount of clarithromycin that we're using. Amikacin is now used generally if we have severe disease, a lot of colonies. If we're thinking about surgery, we really want to bulk up your antibiotic regimen, so we're going to add a really strong medicine that has some potential side effects that we've got to worry about. With the rapidly growing mycobacteria, I think from a practical standpoint, not only is it the clinician's job to pick the right antibiotics to use, but to understand what's going to go into that treatment regimen. So if we're in a rapidly growing mycobacteria arena, generally the first phase of treatment is going to involve an intravenous medication because we don't have many pills to choose from to treat that family of germs. Can the patient have an intravenous access? Do they live in eastern Colorado and they're 60 miles away from the nearest medical center and their Medicare age, and the only way that Medicare will pay for the drug is for the patient to go into an infusion center to receive that drug? If that drug is twice a day, that patient's not going to get that drug. They can't physically get in and back 7 days a week for 2 months. It's physically impossible. So we, the clinician, sort of need to know the social aspect of what the patient is trying to deal with and how can we help them navigate that minefield. Well, this is Sad Puppy. And Sad Puppy is because a physician kept using azithromycin, for a mycobacterial infection, and the germ became resistant to it because they gave one drug. So for mycobacteria, you should never take one drug at a time, one antibiotic, because the germ will become resistant for several reasons, some of which you've already heard this morning. This is a very common thing that we see in patients referred to National Jewish that because of its ease, and it's used for just simple bronchitis or sinusitis so many times, doctors give repeated course of azithromycin and may or may not have checked the sputum to see that they actually are growing mycobacteria. And by the time they check the sputum, find out they're mycobacteria, the mycobacteria have been exposed to this one drug so many times, it's resistant. So we can't use that. That's especially important with rapidly growing mycobacteria because we've only got one non-investigational drug, usually, that in the test tube looks like it works well with minimal side effects, and that's azithromycin or clarithromycin. So that's Sad Puppy, so it should never happen to anyone who's attending this course. So that leads into the fact that the family of azithromycin, clarithromycin are really, really important currently as one of the main family of drugs that we use to treat these groups of infections. And so when we lose that, our outcomes and your outcomes are worse in the long run. And you can have a question of, did you somehow acquire a macrolide-resistant strain of antibiotics? And I'm just going to do this shout out. For a long time, we in the infectious disease world have been pushing the agriculture industry to stop using antibiotics rampantly in agricultural products because we knew that whatever happens in that environment is going to change the microbiology of everything that we consume. And we saw that happen with the drug called ciprofloxacin. So much ciprofloxacin was used in feeds to fatten up cattle or chicken and turkeys. And interestingly, we used to see many of the MAC isolates show susceptibility to cipro, and it's a rarity today that the Mycobacterium avium is susceptible to cipro. And that is multifactorial, but we need to push as a population, stop giving antibiotics to animals unnecessarily. So here's a second case, and I'm getting towards the end here. So you can see that these are two CAT scans, 2010 and 2015. They're not such bad CAT scans. This patient has had a chronic cough for 5 years. Kind of gets a little better, gets a little worse, gets a little better, gets a little worse, but chronically has had a cough. These next three slides, and I'm not going to in any detail other than the clue up here. So this stands for culture and the time, the date. So the first plus or negative is smear versus culture. Smear versus culture. So you can see we first got a sputum culture that was positive. It was an expectorated sputum, so she just hawked something up on her own. IS means induced sputum, and BAL means they had a bronchoscopy. The organism is in this column. This tells how many colonies, or if it didn't grow on the solid media for us to have enough to even count, it was positive only in the liquid media. And then this tells what I did for this patient regarding treatment, and this is a side effect that they had because of something I did to her. So C. diff is a bad diarrhea that you get, probably from the ciprofloxacin that I gave her. So I did some harm to this patient. The illustration I want to make of these next three slides is you'll see the first organism twice in a row was fortuitum. The next was done at an outside lab, and they didn't speciate it. They just said MAC. So that could be anything. Then she grew fortuitum. MAC again. Then we did something. We found it was avium. Then she sent another one in. It's Mycobacterium porcinum. Then it's Mycobacterium intracellulare. Then it's porcinum again. Then it's mucogenum. So she had five different types of mycobacteria in roughly 5 years. My point is this isn't the germ that's morphing from one species to another. She is acquiring different organisms. And so back to the environment and genetics, why is it that a patient can have this many different types of organisms? And I haven't really treated her much. I don't even have her on treatment right now. So we are focusing on, as it turns out, she's picked up Pseudomonas. But it's only rare numbers, so am I going to ultimately treat her with an antibiotic for the Pseudomonas? But the point being, again, we have the tincture of time. We don't have to jump in anything. I don't think we have a trend yet, and her CT scan is not changing. So I alluded to the fact that water, I happen to think that a lot of the acquisition of these organisms, and I'm not a scientist, I'm a clinician, so I want my scientist colleagues to help us figure this out better. But is it water? Yes, it's water. Is it dirt? Yes. Do I personally think it's more water? And I think most of this data would show us that. So is it showers or is it water that we drink? And if we drink it, because that's still the same water source in our houses, how does it get into our lungs? So is it silent reflux or is it silent aspiration from our tongue muscles not working correctly? Yeah, probably both. Can you get it from misters? Yeah, you probably can. And so that goes back to Florida, any of these terrible places that have these misters in the lines for Disney World and things like that. And you just think, oh, I am just standing in a shower of mycobacteria. So think about that. So I think we need to think about drinking water, and this brings in the Environmental Protection Agency and Dr. Falkenham's work and think, okay, environmentally, is there something going on in all of our environment? Is it the shower systems that we have in our homes that do provide a great misting environment, but yet, as already alluded to, the Japanese don't shower much, and there's a high incidence of mycobacteria in them. So I think it can be both. The potable water system has been studied ad nauseum, and there's tons of mycobacteria all throughout the world. It varies from where you are. I think that I focus a lot on reflux and taking a good liquid history. And so one of the things that has to do with reflux may be this thing called a hiatal hernia, where part of your stomach is kind of up above the diaphragm muscle. And so the little flapper or the sphincter can't close appropriately and prevent liquids that are in your stomach that may have mycobacteria and other germs from staying in your stomach. So if you've been forward to pick up a kid or mop the floor or load the dishwasher or garden, maybe gardening isn't because of the dirt you've got your nose in. Maybe it's because you're down on your hands and knees and you had two cups of coffee and a glass of water before you went out to garden, and you're refluxing silently and aspirating that stuff. I'm just saying maybe. So a good liquid history, I think, is really important. And a 12-minute office visit, I can guarantee you, none of your docs are going to do this. So you take your own liquid history, okay? This is just Pilates, okay? Do you go to Pilates after you've had all your beverages and you haven't had anything dense to eat to soak up the liquids that are in your stomach, so you're putting your body in physically a bad position that you might predispose yourself? Are you down on your hands and knees gardening? Are you drinking 64 ounces of water in a very short period of time, so you're topping off your stomach with only liquid, so it's just a matter of when, not if, you're going to reflux? Are you going out to play 18 holes of golf and you have a couple beers or a couple liters of water to stay hydrated, which is all well and good, I'm fine with that, but do you have anything in your stomach to help absorb that water so it's a more dense form, less likely to be refluxed when you change your position? Are you doing crunches in the gym? Are you throwing a medicine ball on your stomach after a set of exercises to strengthen your six-pack? Probably not a good idea if you just have liquids in your stomach. Are you doing downward dog in yoga? Standing on your head? Probably not a great position if we're dealing with this. What do we do to kind of help manage this? Well, probably we should all be making the transition to think about, should we be sleeping with our upper bodies a little more elevated at night, in conjunction with limiting the liquids that we have in our stomach in the evening, so we're not as likely to reflux. But we have to think about other things. Well, if it's already there, how do we get it out? So you're going to try to use some kind of product to clean out your airways, and hopefully all of you patients, your physicians, have given you some type of device to help clean out the airways. Then once we do all that, we need to sort of keep track of what's happening with your sputums. The ATS criteria are there that your docs generally look at to guide them. But again, the point is, just because you meet a criteria, if you have two sputum culture positives, doesn't in and of itself mean that you need to start treatment, I don't believe. It has to be in conjunction with what are your symptoms and what are the radiographs showing and what is a trend. So, summary, assess your symptoms. You assess your own as a patient, and physicians need to take the time to assess what are the symptoms. What does the CT scan, preferably a CT scan, at least initially show? Is it a bad CT scan with cavities or severe bronchiectasis or just a few nodules? How many positive specimens have we obtained, and how positive are they? And that's some changes that we need to be proactive about to push our laboratories to give us better data. Do they show a consistent organism? Is it a MAC-like germ, or is it a rapid grower like abscessus? That's important. Have we looked for other disease states that may predispose you to acquiring these germs? That's important to look for. Have you incorporated airway hygiene and preventing reflux silently into your regimen? And if you have more yes than no symptoms, probably it's time to think about treating. So, I'm a pug fan. So, the point of this slide is just to say, I think at times we all feel, both your doctors and you as the patient, feel like sometimes you're really behind this big barrier, whether it's access to care, whether it's your doc knowing enough, whether it's you feeling confident in asking questions. So we need to remove those barriers, and that's, I think, the big thing that this talk and this series of talks is going to help you do. And join these support groups, because really the squeaky wheel does get the grease. So thanks a lot.